Hey everyone, and welcome back for another video. Today we'll be talking winter layup and the ships of the Great Lakes. I'll put a timestamp for each ship that you'll see in the description. We're looking at Toledo, Ohio. I didn't grow up on the Great Lakes and only made a few trips to Lake Erie and Lake Michigan during the summer when I was growing up, so I never really learned about these ships. While I was trying to film a different video, I ended up watching the Algoma Sioux come off Lake Erie and then head down the Maumee River. I've always enjoyed trucks and trains. Now, I learned that I enjoyed ships too. When I heard about winter layup, I was curious. So after reading several articles, I reached out to Eric Peace. He's the vice president of the Lake Carriers Association. He was kind enough to sit down for an interview with me and answer my questions. Before joining the Lake Carriers Association, Peace spent more than 20 years with the U.S. Coast Guard. He spent many of his days on an icebreaker, similar to what you see here.
It's pretty jarring. So its operations usually take place daylight, especially on the smaller ones that the Coast Guard operates. The reason being is they get fatigued, 17-person crew on those smaller tugs, and it takes a lot out of you when you're operating in harsh conditions with ice, banging around and things like that. So it's a challenge.
I'd like to give a big thank you to him and the Lake Carriers Association. It was truly great to sit down with them. This video will show many of the ships that laid up in Toledo, a few in Detroit, one in Cleveland, and some in Ashtabula. Unfortunately, the weather the day I went to Ashtabula was windy and dreary, but I still got some interesting video, I think. We'll look at the ships as Eric answers my questions about winter layup and why it's so important. Think of this as a beginner's guide to winter layup and the ships of the Great Lakes. P says there are 43 vessels between 13 U.S. flagged companies in the Lake Carriers Association. He says it's one of the oldest associations in the United States, dating back to 1880. I asked Peace how important the Great Lakes are in terms of shipping and the economy.
Broadly speaking, so we generate $226 billion in economic activity. We ship typically around our U.S. flag bulk carriers are shipping about 90 million tons per year, which equates to about 147,000 jobs tied to the Great Lakes industry for shipping.
Peace says the Great Lakes region as a whole is the third largest economy in the world. Only the U.S. and China are larger.
If you combine the region with Canada and the U.S., we are an economic powerhouse and we're the driver of manufacturing in North America.
Not being too familiar, I wanted to know what type of cargo was crossing the Great Lakes.
We're not shipping Nike shoes, I can tell you that. This isn't container shipping, this is bulk carrying. So again, that's why you have those 1,000-foot vessels, which are carrying things like iron ore, coal for power generation, limestone, sand, salt, aggregates, anything that you can think of for infrastructure needs and things like that. Again, manufacturing. So if you divide the Great Lakes about the top of the mitt for Michigan, you look north of that, that's where all your natural resources are, which is your iron ore, your limestone, et cetera. Everything that's south of there tends to be your manufacturing base. So things like Cleveland, Burns Harbor, Indiana, Toledo, those are all where the shipping is coming in with all those raw materials for production purposes.
How critical would you say the Great Lakes are to the United States as well as Canada?
We are an economic powerhouse here, and that's driven by U.S. shipping. So it's vital to our national economic security, and it's also vital to our national security. We have to be able to produce steel. You don't want to get that imported from China. You want to produce U.S. steel here in U.S. factories with U.S. workers. The other aspect of it is we are a Jones Act fleet. And so if you're not familiar with the Jones Act is what basically says you have to have U.S. flagged vessels, U.S. owned, U.S. operated, and U.S. crewed. So that's U.S. mariners operating on U.S. waters that are protecting our everyday way of life.
I then asked about some of the larger ships I've seen.
These started with the 1,000-foot vessels back in the early 80s. Those were constructed, quite a few of them actually down here in Ohio. But those vessels, again, we were talking about what we ship, which is very low-value cargo. So those rocks are not worth a whole lot until it's produced into something that's a finished product. So in order for us to be efficient and actually profitable, you have to ship it in large quantities. And so that's why those 1,000-foot vessels exist. They're moving large quantities, up to 70,000 tons per trip. The other piece of the puzzle is that we had transitioned to pretty revolutionary technology back, I think it was in the 60s, which was self-unloading. And so our vessels can actually swing a boom over 250 feet off the dock and offload 70,000 tons with nobody even being there. And that 70,000 tons can be on your dock within 8 hours.
Peace says technology improvements have been critical for the industry and its continued success.
we recently built the first self-unloading, self-propelled vessel on the Great Lakes in the last 30 years, was recently commissioned by the Interlake Steamship Company. And so we continue to revitalize the fleet, but what's really key is that this is not a caustic environment that you would get from saltwater. And so we can maintain these vessels for a long period of time because of the fresh water. And so that's why you kind of see some of the things where we may have an older vessel that the engines didn't necessarily, or it wasn't worth it to replace the engines, but they'll actually cut the back off of that vessel and put a notch in it, and then they'll buy a new tug and stick the tug in behind it.
The Erie Trader is an example of what he's talking about. The tug is behind the ship, and you can see the notch where it fits in.
Why is it that these ships are able to last for decades and still function as better than when they were built?
So the way the seasons work here is that between March 25th and January 15th, we're running nonstop. So we're moving as much cargo as we possibly can within a defined season. And then January 15th, the Sioux locks close. Those are the locks that connect Lake Superior with the lower lakes. And remember what I said about all your natural resources are pretty much above that line. So when those locks close, there's really no need for us to operate anymore. We'll go to the dock and what we call winter layup. The winter layup will go to facilities, whether it's in Fraser Shipyard up in Lake Superior or down here in or Sturgeon Bay, Wisconsin. There's a large facility there, Bay Ship in Kintiri. And we also have vessels that lay up in Toledo, vessels all across Ohio. If you go all the way out to the Pennsylvania border, and then again in Pennsylvania, we also have a shipyard there. But those are critical times for us because in that two-month period, that's when we revitalize the vessels, you know, update them with navigation equipment, whatever we need to do to keep them maintained. And then you get the next season starts March 25th. So that two-month period, we're investing $120 million into those vessels. In various places, like I said, various places. I think it was $37 million is going into Ohio ports where we've laid up our vessels. $55 million is going into Wisconsin. And then various other places like Pennsylvania, Michigan, etc.
Peace says winter layup is critical for keeping the ships in working order, but he says it also benefits the communities.
The cool story of it is, remember I told you that the new vessel was just built? That same vessel was... That company was hauling the iron ore, which turned into the steel, which built the vessel here on the Great Lakes. So it's a very symbiotic system, very interdependent, but we all work together to make sure we keep it going in the right direction.
During the winter layup, what type of tasks are being done? Are we just talking like oil changes, maybe some new parts here and there? Are we talking full, you know, going over the system completely depending on the vessel?
It all depends. Some vessels will be completely pulled out of the water into dry dock, and they'll have their hull inspected, looking for any kind of weakness in the steel. If there is weakness in the steel, they'll cut it out and replace it. There's other things like engines. We'll be putting in new engines in some vessels, propellers getting shined up, cleaned up, and then again, like I said, navigation equipment, and even crew habitability, right? That's an important aspect of it, because the most important thing is those vessels are beautiful, but if there's nobody there to operate them, it's not going anywhere. So our mariners are vital to us. And so those habitability upgrades, simple things like Wi-Fi that you and I think of as no big deal, well, it is on a ship when you're operating out in Lake Superior to be able to have Wi-Fi and connect with your family or whatever those cases may be.
How critical is it for these massive ships to really have a fine-tooth comb go over them to make sure there aren't any cracks or anything like that?
So we are a very, very heavily regulated industry. So we obviously have our own engineers, which have been operating these vessels for some cases 50, 60 years. So they know what those vessels are inside and out. So our operators will go through and their engineers will look at the vessels. But then on top of that, they'll have American Bureau of Shipping comes in, a third party, and they'll do another inspection of it and do second set of eyes. And then again, we get a third party which comes in, which is the U.S. Coast Guard, who evaluates whether or not we've done what we need to do to make sure that the vessel's safe. So there's all sorts of things in place to make sure that the vessels are operating safely and that the crews are protected.
How do companies decide where their ships are going to lay up?
I don't get into the details of that as a trade association, but I would tell you that my guess is that they're probably looking at economics. They're looking at the work that needs to be done. So depending, like I said, on what the vessel needs, there's only certain areas where they can actually be pulled out of the water based on their size. So those dry docks, so they may choose to go to a dry dock in one area or another. So it's all driven on what the work needs to be done and also economics of whatever contracts the companies make up with the facilities.
I then asked about how important Ohio's ports have been to the Great Lakes and the region.
So Ohio ports are extremely important. Again, if you start out west and you look at Toledo and Sandusky, you go into Lorain, you go into Huron, here in Cleveland, and then keep working your way out to Fairport, Conneaut, Ashtabula. Those are all critical ports. A lot of the shipments that are coming in there, whether it's coal or iron ore, one of a brand new facility at Cleveland Cliffs out in Toledo. So those are vital ports for making sure that we can get those cargoes into them for the raw materials, but then also the finished products which are produced at those facilities. A lot of these facilities are only able to accept cargo via cell phone loading vessel because of their location. They may not have rail into there, and you're not going to ship 2,000 trucks worth of iron ore from Superior down here and be efficient or effective.
Here he's talking about the port of Toledo. This is the Algoma Sioux heading down the river to illustrate the point he's about to make.
Toledo's vital, and one of the issues we face in Toledo is shoaling. So we get a lot of sediment that gets deposited in the Maumee River, and there's also movement out here on the lake where it's moving sediment into those facilities. So it's a constant effort to keep the Army Corps engaged, funded, so that we can keep those areas cleaned out that the vessels can make it through. One of the huge issues for every inch of draft, so inch of draft is how much the vessel actually sits down in the water. For every inch of draft we lose, our largest vessels lose 270 tons per shipment. So that's just an inch. So if you lose 3 feet, you're talking almost 10,000 tons per shipment, which again reduces the efficiency and effectiveness of the system.
Next, we'll head to Cleveland. Unfortunately, Cleveland Burke Lakefront Airport limits where I can fly my drone, so I was only able to record the more than 80-year-old SS Alpina. I could see several workers on the vessel and the engine was running. Peace says the Port of Cleveland hinges on the nearby Cleveland Cliffs facility.
What we do is we'll bring in cargo on our large 1,000-foot vessels, park them at the end of the actual entrance to the river, offload those 70,000 tons, and then we'll have smaller ships come in and do what we call shuttles. And those smaller ships will load, take it up the river, which the Cuyahoga River is the windiest, narrowest river that's navigated by ships of this size, I think probably in the world. So our mariners are extremely talented.
This was all I could see in Cleveland, and it was pretty windy this day, so I couldn't put my drone up too high or too far. I then went to Ashtabula. The weather did not cooperate with me when I got there, but I was able to capture some video of the ships.
So Ashtabula is, again, another critical port. A lot of those facilities between Ashtabula and Conneaut, the stuff that goes in there is actually being taken down to Pittsburgh. So we'll load there, and then they'll take it to the steel mills in Pittsburgh as well down there. So there's a lot of critical functions that are going on. And again, don't forget that we're shipping aggregate as well, so things to make roads, asphalt, all of those infrastructure projects. So you got the infrastructure bill that just passed. None of that's possible without the shipment of these cargoes that make the raw material, those raw materials that make the actual finished product. So your steel, your rebar, everything that goes into your bridges, all those revitalization projects are dependent on what gets shipped here.
I saved my toughest question for last. Does Peace have a favorite vessel on the water?
I love them all. Again, because we're a trade association, we love all of our vessels. But yeah, they're all unique and different. It's a fantastic system. I love this job. The reason I love this job is because we work together with all of these companies to maintain safety and also advocate for them. And what they do is, like I said before, is vital to our national economic security. So that's just really plays to my favorite thing, which is to serve. You know, after leaving the service, I struggled with trying to find a job that I can serve in. And this one definitely you can serve in, and I couldn't be happier to serve those mariners that are out there doing just vital national security work.
Well, that's it. I hope you enjoyed this video and the information from Eric. Again, I'm truly thankful he agreed to be a part of this. You can learn more about the Lake Carriers Association and the Great Lakes by clicking the link in the description. Now you'll see all the video of the ships that I caught without anything except some nearby gulls and the sound of the water. Let me know if you have anything else to add about winter layups or the ships of the Great Lakes. Until our next video, I hope you have a great day.